Thank you. So my name is VEGARD, GRØSLIE, WENNESLAND. I am on the 22nd of July. I was the vice president of the Oslo branch of AUF. I was on the island. I'm a survivor. I continued with politics afterwards, but I now mainly work for a trade union. So I mean, thank you first of all for the presentations, and I was in the group with Marianne, who decided on the memorial site at Utøya. But I think I would like to spend my few minutes to add another perspective to the importance of that memorial site, because for the labor youth as an organization, being attacked as we were on the 22nd of July, it wasn't, and you know, it wasn't a random attack. It was because we were AUF. It was because of the policies that we represent and the ideology that we represent. I say we now, but I don't represent AUF in this situation, just myself. But it was important to move on and to kind of build the organization and show that we were strong and we will get through this. And one of the aspects of that, that was to kind of, as we say in Norwegian, take back the island. A late friend of mine once said it better, we are all authors of our own life story. We can decide what we want our story to be. And for AUF, it became important that Utøya not became a symbol of terrorism, of death, of killings, but it will always be the crime scene. It will always be the scene of it, and we don't want to escape that fact. But we want it to be the symbol of democracy, of youth engagement, of exchange of ideas, of kind of conflict of ideas, of debating. And we want Utøya to remain that symbol. Yes, with a very, very hard and tough history, but to continue to be a symbol of political active youth. So creating a memorial site, as we did, was a way of bringing the very difficult and troubled history into that future scene and that future symbol as an island of continued democratic kind of engagement and exchange of ideas. But there was another aspect of this as well, and this was rebuilding of the whole island itself. And these two things are very connected. I don't think you would have had a very successful return to the island if you didn't have a successful memorial site, but I also don't think you would have had a very successful kind of return to the island if the islands and its infrastructure didn't work in a way that made it possible to continue to receive youth. It was, to be honest, you know, kind of run down buildings. It needed some renovating. And through very generous donations from you know, concerned citizens, small donations to big donations from trade unions and the Labour Party and other organizations, we managed to build and reconstruct an island in which this democratic kind of exchange and youth involvement can thrive. They've had now two summer camps on the island. The last one when kind of everything, this summer when everything was fully reconstructed. And it's again kind of a scene for this engaged youth trying just to make the world a better place and to kind of figure out how to evolve the Labour Party policies to make, you know, Norwegian society, I was about to say great again, but let's not. that's definitely far away from our ideas. To make you know, Norway a more fair place, it takes care of each other in a better way, poor people, the multicultural society, which most certainly was one of the main ideas that was under attack on the 22nd of July. And so I think. So you have the memorial site, but you also have the way that you've kept some of the older buildings. This was, as Norwegians I'm sure will know, there were some controversies over which buildings to kind of raise and which where to build new ones, but they managed to also, with old buildings, especially one where 13 people, youth, were killed inside this one building, and managed to construct like a site around this, a building around the building, to say, it in that way, in which the bereaved could come there and see the place where they where their loved ones were killed, but which also includes a learning center. So now it's not only a place for Norwegian youth, but international people are coming there to learn about what happened in Utøya, but also like about the problems in society now, right wing extremism, which hasn't gone down since the 22nd of July. On the contrary, they learn about how to deal with bullying. They learn about how to deal with hate on the internet. So we managed to do these two things, the memorial site, but also create the site for learning on Utøya as well, which really kind of merges, I think, the two histories, the two stories well, remembering the past, but also looking into the future, bringing the ideas of the labor youth and how, how can you, through these ideas, make the world a better place.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. I'm Arne Johan Vetlesen, professor of philosophy at the University of Oslo. I have been working on evil for much too long. I would like to start by limiting my remarks, my comments, to Jonas Dahlberg's memory wound, and to comment on some of the things that KJETIL RØED said when he addressed that as one of these three works of art. First of all, I think it's important to raise the following question: what do we expect from such a work of art? What is its task? What is its mandate? Now, this immediately raises the question, who is asking? Who is this we? I will come back to that. Now, one could say that such a work of art should help restore meaning, since this is a work of art that is being commissioned in the aftermath of a great rupture, in the aftermath of a massacre. But this is precisely what Jonas Dahlberg's memory wound refuses to do on my reading of it. It refuses to restore or help us restore meaning in the aftermath of what came to pass at Utøya. Now, KJETIL RØED, in his comments on memory wound, said, I quote, Dahlberg's memory wound is dislodged from everyday solidarity. It freezes the feeling of loss. It is heartless. It is too insistent, too imposing. End of quote. I agree with this as a way of interpreting Dahlberg's work. And one might say, using a word that KJETIL RØED did not use, that it mimics the deed, or it comes too close to mimicking the deed. And this is, of course, to do with the physical rupture in the landscape. That is, so to speak, the essence of this work. Now, perhaps I then depart from Kjetil Rød's conclusion, if there is such a thing as a conclusion, that I think the quality of memory wound is that it has precisely these characteristics that Rød mentions. And I think that is a quality also because we need to look at the different works of art, the different monuments. So now the clearing has been realized at Utøya, like Marianne Heier showed us. And I think that also we have relocating the past, and we also have this exhibition. So I think we should look at these three or four memorials as complementary, as sort of fulfilling different roles or satisfying different needs. And from that perspective, taking all of them into account, I think it's a good thing that one of these works, which is the work of art, expresses this rupture and the brutality, the lack of prospect of healing, of repairing, of making good again in the aftermath of the killing there of 69 persons. If there is time, I would like to use a couple of minutes also on addressing this we. Can I do that?
You may.
Thank you. Kjetil Rød posed this question, who is this we, in connection with this letter that he quoted from the newspaper Aftenposten. It's a letter in support of realizing Dahlberg's memory wound. And this is a very pertinent question to ask. Who is this we? And I would like to connect that question to the deed, to what Anders Behring Breivik did on the 22nd of July, namely in asking the question, who was attacked? Who was he intending to attack in a very meticulous, deliberate manner at that? And in the immediate aftermath, politicians, public persons, intellectuals, and so on, who were called upon to comment, said Norway was attacked, or Norwegians were attacked, or our way of living was attacked. So we were all attacked. And Siv Jensen, the leader of the Progressive Party, Fremskrittspartiet, said that today we are all members of AUF. I dag vi alle AUF-ere. Knowing very well that Anders Behring Breivik, the perpetrator, for very many years was a member of the youth wing of her party, and he was attacking members of the youth wing of a rival political party, the AUF. Okay, so that was kind of bracketed. And I think supplementary to that, there was a kind of bracketing or silencing or in any way under communication of the fact that one party, or members of the youth thing of one particular party, was attacked. So I think there is some hollowness, even hypocrisy, to this manner of speaking that we were attacked, or that we were all attacked. And I think that this very much still feeds into, this is something that is still very active, that there is no homogeneous subject. There are a number of subjects, and they are heterogeneous, and they are partly in conflict. They have different points of view from which to relate to, from which to try and come to terms with what happened. And these points of view are in conflict. And I think that that fact has been too much silenced in the public debate in Norway. And I would just like to add to that, to show how relevant this is today, 5.5 years later. We don't know whether Dahlberg's work of art will be realized. We simply don't know. And the fact that after so long time we still don't know, I think, at least for me, makes for a growing sense that it will not be realized.
In the aftermath of 9/11, my colleagues and collaborators thought, what are the tasks if we need to reconnect a city? What are the tasks that we do collectively? And what we came to think of were four words: remember, respect, learn, and connect. And in the aftermath, so we're now 15 years later, while these all go on simultaneously, what we have found is that remember, respect, learn, and connect take precedence at different moments in time as things unfold. So I would have certainly heard in the discourse that has been shared today these issues of remember, respect, learn, and connect, and how pressing this is in understanding a work of art. How do we understand how these are interwoven with the site, with what's put up there, with how we consider the needs of many, many people who have things in common, but also things in opposition. It's been really an honor for us to hear from everyone. And so I just want to open it up to any thoughts that anyone has at this point. Yeah.
I would like to comment a bit further on this notion of we, which is, I think, extremely interesting, because we live in a time where everybody more or less are going around and afraid of some kind of terror attack, something like that. And if you look at the terror attacks from the last few years, not just Breivik or 9/11, there's always in the aftermath some kind of rhetorics which mixes a we with a true story. And if you tell a story which kind of differs from the we, it's often repressed or looked upon as something which is almost allied with the enemy or something like that. An interesting example in after 9/11 is Gore Vidal, which is one of the more interesting intellectuals in the US after that, since the 1950s. He wrote an essay about all the attacks on other countries, kind of humanitarian attacks, so to speak, and said that, well, we had it coming, more or less. We had it coming. And this, firstly, was an article, and it didn't get it on print in New Times, The Atlantic. Nobody wanted to print it. And that, I think, has to do with this kind of sense of we and the mix of post-traumatic emotions and the right story. So it's kind of a censorship that enters the we, in a sense, as well. You could also see it when the Charlie Hebdo was criticized, everybody said, I'm Charlie Hebdo. What does that mean, really? You're not Charlie Hebdo, you're not a drawer. It doesn't, nobody does drawings like that, mostly. And a story of my own is, I wrote a commentary for Aftenposten, the same newspaper we talked about earlier, where I said that I am not Charlie Hebdo, and talked about similarities between Nazi satire in the 30s, making fun of the Jews, and Muslim satire in Charlie Hebdo, which is very real. I looked through almost everything, and it's very real. But then I got threats, and you know, we're the terrorists, you're not a part of us, and stuff like that. You know? So it's kind of, this is dangerous, you know, because it's repressive, or it can be repressive.
Yes. Post 9/11, what we saw was that it repressed the learn. We weren't allowed to learn.
No, no.
There was a thing that happened, and we had to attack back, and that was it. So it was very, very difficult. Do you know the American expression, the chickens come home to roost? Well, you weren't supposed to say that either.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I think one of the things that I know was repressed after 22nd of July was hatred. I mean, so I lost friends. I know people who lost girlfriends at the age of like 16. Parents lost their children. Grandparents had to bury their grandchildren. Two 14-year-olds were killed at Utøya. Of course, that nurtures hatred. Mm. That was not what we talked about. We talked about love, respect, openness, more democratic society. And I think that had its virtues. I think kind of it felt right. I was in the middle of it. It felt right. But I think looking back with the benefit of hindsight and everything, I mean, where was the room to express the hatred towards the perpetrator, first and foremost? I mean, that was probably the easiest thing to do. But maybe towards, you know, society in general. How did this homegrown man like see through all the cracks in our society? Why did no one pick him up? Why wasn't he stopped earlier? All these things that are really legitimate concern, legitimate reasons for hatred or for, I don't know, harsh criticism or whatever you want to call it, we're certainly pressed. But did we manage to, on the other side then, did we manage to like bring society together when its very fundamental ideas were threatened? Yeah. And so if AUF, I'm sure some people in the AUF wanted to do this, went out and said he was part of the Progress Party. It was like 2 months before an election. Would have felt good for someone. I mean, just see Jensen saying that she's an AUFer is, for an AUFer is, I don't know how to say, very weird. She is one of the main, the Progress Party is one of our main political opponents. So having their leader go out and say that today we are all a member of the Labour Youth is strange, but it was a very, you know, special time, and the political parties came together. But we don't know what would have happened if we would have taken that, challenged the we, taken that confrontation right away. We don't know. I mean, but would the election, would the dialogue, would the public debate have been any prettier? I don't think so. But is that good or bad? I don't know. Like we it's too late to kind of go back and try that again. But it took several years before people were starting to talk about hatred, at the very least. And we still haven't come there that we're starting. I don't think any reasonable politician would go out and say that the Progress Party has, you know, any form of responsibility, because they don't. But like you could totally see that happening in a more, in a society where the we is challenged more, right? I'm just not sure it would have helped in the immediate aftermath. So I don't know. Lebanon sure has its issues.
No, I've always raised this question. there's two things in Norway. The whole debate after that, as if this peace nation, someone scratched this thought that Norway is a peace nation forever. And the fact that, okay, so there's two things. The fact that Norway don't have a sculpture monument for the soldier who go and fight the enemy from outside, you know, like Élysée, Champs-Élysées in France or in any other country, that Norway don't have this. This fact is in the culture that we've never been in war and that we are a peace nation. And the second is, it's a question also, as Mr. Wilson said, how come till now we didn't manage to make a monument for what happened in a state official monument, let's say, after 2011, on 27 July. And it's really a question, and of course it leads us to this debate of we and them, and that's not only Bush who started this, if you're not with us, you are against us. It's also a debate since Edward Said wrote about this a long time ago, about them and us and we. So the enemy from inside, I think Norway, in my opinion, like you get so confused on how to deal with this that till now, and I totally understand that we're not able to do a monument for this attack because it's really confusing. If the enemy was from the outside, as I said in my paper, if he was Muslim and better to be born outside, not also born in the country and raised under the principle of this country, then it would be easy to do a monument and to do a national monument, kind of. I believe in that. But also, we have to re-question what does it mean to be a peace nation. Are we really Norway as a peace nation? And shock that, how can we produce this kind of enemy from inside? I don't know what kind of debate, but there should be a debate on, I don't know, like I know Norway, I came from Lebanon, and south of Lebanon is full of cluster bombs, and I know Norway is in the industry of the cluster bomb, like example. So re-questioning this peace nation again, or re-questioning of what does that mean to be a NATO and bomb, it's really not understand it. So I think the shocking was like someone from us who went and killed, it was a shock that we were not able to open a discussion, and if it will happen again or not, and what we do, what kind of debate we should open if this continues. I don't know if the idea is.
Yeah, I was just thinking, obviously, as I said as well, while working on listening, it was very clear that that had to be a non-political memorial, since the bereaved were not there because of their ideological convictions necessarily. So even though the attack was politically motivated, that had to be kind of ideologically neutral space. But still, I find it very personally, very strange how the political aspects in this, I mean, this was a politically motivated, horrible act of killing. It was so violent, it's almost impossible to understand that it is real, it's true, it happened. And how the political thinking and luggage behind that action still manages to kind of go unaddressed. I mean, this person did not act in a vacuum. He came from somewhere. And his whole manifesto, I have never read it, and never will, but as far as I understand, it consists basically of quotes from other pieces of writing. So this is not something that comes out of nowhere. And that's maybe something that I personally miss, both in the debate about this, and also maybe if we look at all the memorials and the work that is being done in how to process the trauma that actually affects very many people more than the directly affected by this, why is it so difficult to address the political aspect of this? Why is that so much more difficult than all the other aspects? And there is something in this that, of course, this has to do with power. other interests being dragged into something that is very, very unflattering. But I think it's really important. That needs to be addressed. It's not a general kind of, oh, that was a very sad thing that happened. No, it was a political gesture. It was conscious. And the reason why, I mean, when it passed through in the court, they declared him not to be mentally insane. He knew what he was doing. And that, I think we need to address that much more than we do.
We do have to end. We've been given the signal.
Yeah, I just have one more question. I'm really curious to if they can answer me. How come after this attack, the right wing win again?
Yeah.
I mean, like this is say a lot. I mean,
yes.
Say a lot. Like after this kind of and the fact that we are not able to believe that it happened. I think we should start to believe that it happened, and it will happen again, maybe, and hope not. And of course, and that's a question of like after all this, the right wing went and
so
went again.
Part of this is that I my own experience since 9/11 is that yeah, in the aftermath of trauma, there is a long, it's a long processing. And you actually can't speak about the hardest, whatever the hardest parts are, those aren't the first ones you get to. So obviously, the hardest part is the political conflicts. Are the deeper ruptures in society, those aren't the first things that you talk about in the healing. The first thing you have to talk about is love. And the political comes later. But I would just like to leave this with a question for me, which is that I'm a psychiatrist, of course, so this is a psychiatrist's question. That here you've chosen this memorial about rupture, in which there's a rupture, an irremediable rupture, and but you haven't built it. And I just find that why would you build a memorial with an irremediable rupture as a nation of peace? That question is in my heart. So we have to close and go to lunch, and thank you all so much for such amazing things.